greetings. We're examining scripture harmonization. And in part two, I reviewed an example of finding one definition of several. Now I would like to discuss something I call generous and forgiving eyes. This is how I describe the imbalanced scales people use. When we are young, our world starts out with our mother. She is the womb we begin our life in. Her womb is where we hear our first sounds and receive the spark of life. Then we are born into the cold world of separation. But even then, our mother's body feeds us and cares for all our needs. As we grow, she feeds us and clothes us and tends to us. And we often place her on a pedestal of perfection and reverence. So we begin our lives seeing our mothers as somewhat perfect. We may consider her the most beautiful woman in the world. Until we reach the age when we are aware of our own sensations of adulthood. Then as we mature, we begin to develop our own standard of what appeals to us. Thankfully, in normal, healthy adults, that appeal leads us away from our mother. At which time, we may enter the phase of beginning to critique our parents. And our generous eyes toward our mothers may begin to see the imperfections her humanity encompasses. Still, we love our mother, but hopefully with a more mature and honest appraisal of her true self as a person. There is actually a point to this example. It is tempting to see our religion as we view our mother with generous eyes. I think people born into a religion are more likely to exhibit this tendency. And this directly can stultify or hinder our ability to examine and harmonize scriptures with honesty. This is the gist of this video series. We're examining scripture harmonization. We each view our own scriptures with generous eyes. While we may view the scriptures of other religions with hostile intentions. Please don't get me wrong. When conscious decisions are made to follow a religion by an adult or an honest seeker of truth, their decision would not have been based on an assumption of truth. In fact, the more probable path to a religion is based on being convinced of the validity of the new religion. A Christian born into a Christian family will learn initially by being directly taught. A Muslim born into a Muslim home will be force-fed Islam as if it is the only truth. But those who change religions will likely have done so through some mental thought process. How does that apply to harmonization, you may ask? A Christian views the world assuming the Bible is God's revelation of truth. A Muslim views the world assuming the Quran is perfect truth. Ultimately, both positions cannot be simultaneously correct. And the conflict between these two in particular is the cosmic battle of the last days. Harmonization is the process of trying to identify the single best coherent message presented by the text. And if one is comparing one's own text against that of another religion, it is not a valid comparison if it is done with generous eyes toward your scriptures while you wage jihad against other scriptures. Now, to show an example, I just intentionally biased my statement. By using the word jihad, I associated the generous eyes to the Muslim position. We must be accurate and honest when we compare scriptures. That requires us, to the best of our abilities, to recognize our biases. In one context, between Christian brothers, there may certainly be differences of interpretation. But all Christians must be aware that any time a Muslim mentions the Bible, it is with intent and agenda. A Muslim will never reference a verse of the Bible that refutes or disproves the Quran. This goes back to the assumption the Quran is perfect truth. Any verse of the Bible that refutes the Quran must therefore be considered false. And how does this contribute to the harmonization discussion? Remember, before the harmonization comes the aggregation phase. The best path to the truth is getting the whole truth, meaning be thorough in aggregation. Islamic mention of the Bible has always been ripped out of context in my 15 years of exchanging with Islamic apologists. The true meaning of any Bible passage will include the context and deserves honest eyes with no agenda. And recognize that honest eyes are not necessarily antagonistic eyes. The truth is the truth, and it is what we look for. The challenge comes when Muslims say, just ignore the truth you think you know, and accept this story based on our assumed truth. But a Muslim will not say their information is an assumed truth. But regarding harmonization, always respect the context and the text itself, and incorporate all the related scriptures identified in the aggregation phase of the study. In the fields of mathematics and statistics, there are ways to represent data. It may be called trend lines, or linear regression, or curve fitting. It is a way to best try and fit an equation to a set of data to find the best equation that most closely matches the data. Here is just one example graphic I found on Wiki. It does not matter what this is a graph of. The point is that this scattered data, the blue dots, can be best described by this red line. Imagine the blue dots represent the many scriptures on a topic, and the red line represents the truth. Think of harmonization as the line, truth, that best fits all the scriptures. We often get off into error when we only consider some of the scriptures, or worse, only a single scripture. Look, these scriptures all support predestination. But these support free will Arminianism. Can't you see? And so both positions use only part of the scriptures, possibly ignoring these that are neutral to either position. And neither ends up with the whole truth. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. In part 4, I think I need to begin to walk through some examples of confused Islamic claims.